come right down toward us. I can see Mrs. Kennedy.
Kennedy liked the media. He liked reporters. He liked editors. He liked the process.
The press is having a field day.
Dallas was known at that time, was known as a center of kind of right-wing, violent political activity.
As we came into the heart of Dallas, I was in the first press bus, and the crowds were wonderful. It was a sunny day, beautiful day.
And then as they turned the corner, there was this loud, explosive sound.
Then it clicked in me. I don't know what's happening, but something here is really wrong.
I picked up the phone and said, UPI. This voice was screaming.
Three shots were fired at the motorcade. Make it a bulletin precinct.
Three shots, one instant. One instant that changed this country forever. Welcome to CNN Presents. I'm Aaron Brown. Almost everyone of a certain age can tell you where they were, what they were doing on November 22nd, 1963, that dark day in Dallas, the day President John F. Kennedy was assassinated. They can tell you how, for the first time, America turned not to print or radio, but to television as the unimaginable played out before our eyes. They can tell you how we hung on every word, every image, from those still struggling to make sense of the senseless. Nearly 40 years later, those journalists who were there can still recall with vivid, gripping detail the minutes and the hours and the days of one of the most traumatic events in modern American history. So who better to tell the story? That's what we thought when we began. President Kennedy Has Been Shot, a documentary from Academy Award-winning filmmaker Gerardine Wersberg.
Everybody kept twisting around and saying, where's Jackie? Where's Jackie? Well, Jackie was standing beside me in the kitchen door, and she was smiling mischievously. And the more they went on saying, where's Jackie? Twisting around, she sort of giggled and waited more. And then she made her tactically delayed entrance and to huge cheers. And she looked glowing because she was wearing this pillbox hat in pink and her glossy hair. And the cameraman, Mo Levy, we looked at each other and I said to Mo, well, if nothing else happens, we got a story in Jackie.
2 years ago, I said that, introduced myself in Paris by saying that I was the man who had accompanied Mrs. Kennedy to Paris. I'm getting that same sensation as I travel around Texas. Nobody wonders what Lyndon and I wear.
The whole trip to Texas was a what was called a political fence-mending trip. The governor, John Connally, was rather conservative. There was a senator, Ralph Yarborough, who was very liberal. They didn't get along. The vice president, of course, Lyndon Johnson, was from Texas. And President Kennedy was already looking forward to the 1964 elections, presidential campaign. Certainly did not want to lose Texas because of a rift between the state senior senator and its governor.
Now Air Force Number One taxiing in. And the crowd below cheering.
Adlai Stevenson had been attacked there just a few weeks before, and Dallas was known at that time, it was known as a center of kind of right-wing, violent political activity. So there had been some talk about that. Would President Kennedy be safe?
There's Mrs. Kennedy, and the crowd yells, and the President of the United States. Shaking hands now with the Dallas people, Governor and Mrs. Connally.
I got off the press plane, and I was following the president and Jackie down the fence line. And it was wonderful. The people who were there, they were very warm and cheerful. And mostly, I noticed, they were young.
And here they come, right down toward us. I can see Mrs. Kennedy.
They went up and down the fence line there, and it was just the same thing, touching and shaking hands and posing with kids and that sort of thing. And then they got into the limousine.
Driving his own car, personally escorting it with the chief of police, the presidential car, moving out.
After he arrived and got in the motorcade and started his the tour through downtown Dallas from Love Field, everybody sort of took a break. There was going to be a slight pause while the motorcade went through town, and then it would all pick up again, the activity. When the president reached the trademark where he was going to deliver a major speech.
Merriman Smith, who was our White House correspondent, was traveling with the White House group. And he would, of course, report the president's remarks, what he was saying.
Smitty was almost a caricature of, he could have been right out of Central Casting. His suit was rather rumpled. He sort of talked out of the side of his mouth. I expected to see a press card in his hat.
The crowd down there was absolutely beautiful, and nothing went wrong where I was. The police had seen to it that they had extra patrols all over the motorcade route. The crowd just surged up and down the street and cheered along Main Street as the motorcade came past.
I took a position on the corner right across the street from the depository building. And as the motorcade approached, I was caught up in it like everybody else. There were the motorcycle escorts. And then as the limo bearing the Connollys and the Kennedys came, I was riveted by the appearance of the Kennedys. They just looked great. They looked like a first couple should look. And then as they turned the corner, there was this loud, explosive sound.
We see Michael, marine biologist, Broadway star, or maybe astronaut. At Microsoft, we started Club Tech with Boys and Girls Clubs of America, so kids learn more than just what computers can do. They learn what they themselves can do.
I've gotten smarter about what I put in my body. That's why I take Centrum.
Centrum? It's more complete.
With Centrum, you're getting the best that today's nutritional science has discovered. That's the completeness of Centrum.
Centrum? I just feel better knowing I'm taking it.
Centrum, more complete from A to Zinc.
With every flood comes a flood of emotions. Every fire, a spark of uncertainty and loss of control. That's why when fire and water take control of your life, we help you take it back. Serve Pro, like it never even happened.
What are you girls giggling about?
There's always something irresistible in the kitchen at Romano's Macaroni Grill. Succulent shrimp, grilled chicken and penne pasta baked in a creamy Parmesan sauce. Come savor our penne rustica, only at Romano's Macaroni Grill. Welcome into our kitchen and into our heart.
Whoa, slow down. Let's see what's going on here.
Yeah, the new Yellow Pages are out.
Let's see which one they pick, Yellow Book or the other book.
He's taking a Yellow Book.
Ah, Yellow Book.
You see what she's choosing?
I told you they all pick Yellow Book.
Oh, no. Yellow Book.
Look, she's taking one of ours.
Yeah.
Yellow Book.
Again.
I told you we're in trouble.
Hey, we work for the phone company. What are you doing?
I can see why people love it.
Today, people are choosing Yellow Book, not that other book. Call 1-800-YB-YELLOW.
Paula Zahn. Experience is her edge. News and newsmakers, her focus. Join Paula live every night and you'll know more. More than what, more than how, more than why. Smart, fair-minded, news with the people making it. Paula Zahn now. Monday and every weeknight, 8 Eastern on CNN.
Turned into Dealey Plaza, and I looked at my watch. I was going to have to do a radio piece for the News on the Hour at 1 o'clock. So I began making a couple of notes, thinking what I would use from the speech in the radio piece. And then there was a bang.
The sound, the rhythm of it, there was no question in my mind. It was bang, bang, bang.
Things were happening in the limousine. Mr. Kennedy had, his arms had gone up and he was beginning to topple to the left. And Jackie came out of her seat and was coming up over him. And about that time, I guess Secret Service man from the following car jumped over the left rear fender of the car and covered them both. And they sped off.
The people on the grassy knoll, it looked like just a great wind had flattened them out. They were all lying down. And I remember as we first edged up, there was this young man right down on the curb with a little boy, with his arm around the boy, and they were lying on the ground, and he was pounding the earth with his hand, and he was protecting his son, and he was hammering the earth, and instantly you knew this was something horrible.
At the time of the shot, Smitty grabbed a phone in the car. The press car had a mobile telephone in it, and dialed the office. And I was standing next to a bank of phones by the news desk, and the phone rang, and I sort of looked around to see if somebody else was going to answer it, but there was no one, so I picked up the phone and said, UPI. And this voice that I immediately recognized on the other end was screaming, "Three shots were fired at the motorcade!" I nearly dropped the phone. I grabbed it, I sort of screwed it into my ear, and said what I said next was, "I can't hear you." I had heard him perfectly, of course, but I was trying to buy myself some time. I just didn't know what to do. Screamed it again, even louder. "Three shots were fired at the motorcade. Make it a bulletin precede."
I put out a bulletin. The three shots had been fired at the motorcade. Bingo. That's all. And immediately the wire stopped. New York runs that main wire, and it said, hold up, Dallas, the wire is yours.
And he's pushed a little brake lever, and it stopped the story in the middle of a sentence, actually, and typed the bulletin that then would ring five bells all around the world. And this would be the first word anybody in television, radio, or newspapers had that shots were fired at the motorcade.
I heard bing, 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 and kind of looked up. And Eddie's standing there at the United Press printer, and he says, it says shots rang out in streets of Dallas with the president going by. And I said, whoa. And we were deciding what to do about getting on the air because we didn't have a camera there at the time. We learned at that point that you always have a warm camera in the newsroom and ready to go.
Here is a special bulletin from Dallas, Texas. Three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade today in downtown Dallas, Texas. This is ABC Radio.
I suspected something was wrong with it in the seconds that the motorcade whizzed past me. Then it clicked in me. I don't know what's happened, but something here is really wrong. And so I hightailed it back to the station. My one thing was, I got to get back to KRLD with the old journalism action. You know, there's a story here. I don't know what the story is, but there's a story here, and there's no story worth a damn unless you can get it out.
I am at the hospital now. The president was taken in
a few minutes ago, lifted from the car, placed on a stretcher. He was motionless. The first lady leaned over him, crying. Governor Connally of Texas was also wounded. It's uncertain at this moment.
It was a frozen scene inside the car. Jackie was not speaking to anyone, and nobody was speaking to her. After a minute or so, the Clint Hill, who was the Secret Service man, who sort of covered himself with glory that day, but he was standing next to the car, and he took off his jacket and put it over Kennedy's head and shoulders.
When I got to Parkland, the place had already been cordoned off. The limousine was still there. Its doors were standing open. The bouquet of roses was lying on the back seat. Senator Ralph Yarbrough was just broken up, completely in tears. Congressman Jim Wright, they were all talking in hushed tones.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
113 was brought from the downtown area, code 3, to Elm and Houston. With caution.
43 en route.
Well, I got to Dealey Plaza probably, I'd say, no more than 10 minutes after the shots had been fired, and it was already a scene of total chaos. At the very beginning, the building was sealed. There were several reporters who had got in instantly. Kent Biffle, Tom Allier, Pierce Allman.
Ran up the sidewalk, up the steps to the depository building, and asked a man where a phone was. He jerked his thumb and he said, in there. And the whole time that I was running, I'm thinking, you've got to get this on the air, but what? What do you say? It looked to me like the president was shot. If in that very brief, chaotic visual moment, if what I saw and registered was accurate, it looked to me as if it was fatal. But what do you say?
Attention all squads, the suspect from Elm and Houston is reported to be an unknown white male, about 30, slender build, 5 feet 10 inches tall, 106 pounds. No further description.
Well, we got a call from Tom Allier, who was locked in on the sixth floor. He says, I'm up here, and we've got the chicken bones, we've got the gun, we've got everything. And he says, but I can't get that film out of there. And I said, you got a piece of tape? And he said, yeah. And I said, tape it up real good and throw it out the back window. It was the back side to the school book depository, and we were down there catching film coming out. We have a piece of film we would like to show you now. Bert Shipp is our chief photographer and assistant news director of WFAA television. This is... Well, roll the film, Bert, and if you would narrate it, please.
Tom Allier, one of our reporters and photographers, shot this film, and...
This film was thrown out one of the windows and developed in the last 10 or 15 minutes here and on the air.
But this is the inside of the building where the sniper was. Now the film starts getting a little bad. Looks like Tom lost his loop.
We were in such a hurry to get the film on the air that we were actually taking it out of the processing soup and putting it straight on the air without even editing it, putting it on the air wet.
The president was whisked to Parkland Hospital, which is located about a mile and a half from this site, which would make it about 3 miles from the...
The position was just that I was up on the balcony there with a microphone, and I didn't even have a floor man with me. And what little I knew was not much, other than there was something amiss because the motorcade did not stop, and it went on by. And then it was very shortly after that that I had a doctor that I knew from Parkland. Came up and whispered in my ear.
Yes. And who are you, sir?
I don't want to be identified.
We have just been told by a member of the staff at Parkland Hospital the president is dead. This is not, what is the governor's condition?
He's been shot.
Remember, we had a big old long mic, and I put that mic under my arm, and I said, what?
how do you know? And he said, I just called the emergency room and he's DOA. And so I knew my source and I knew that he was right, and I then said it.
Let us recall for you now what has transpired in this.
KRLD is reporting they've been told by somebody at the hospital the president's dead. Only a rumor, but they've been told that KRLD is saying.
Well, that's a repeat of something that you heard reported to you directly a moment ago from KRLD television in Dallas, and that is the rumor that has reached them at the hotel that the president is dead. Totally unconfirmed, apparently, as yet.
At Hotels.com, we really know our way around hotels. We visit thousands of hotels to find you the best prices at the best places. Hotels.com. Best prices, best places, guaranteed.
CNN this Monday afternoon. Arnold Schwarzenegger becomes governor of California. Join Judy Woodruff live from the Schwarzenegger inauguration. CNN Monday afternoon, 2 Eastern.
Increase energy, reshape your body in record time with Fitness Made Simple's new 45-minute fat-burning workout.
There are no tricky dance moves, no high-impact gyrations, just lightweight training done at a heart-pumping cardio pace to build lean muscle and burn pounds of fat.
Work out at home with fitness celebrity John Baisdow doing exercises to sculpt your chest, back, shoulders, arms, legs, and abs. Call now or order online at fitnessmadesimple.com.
Fitness Made Simple, bringing real results to real people.
How accidents occur, how everything happens so fast. Then you think about how you can create anti-roll technology that reacts even faster. You think about that, then you build.
The Volvo XC90, the only SUV equipped with a roll stability control system to help prevent rollover and guided by conscience.
CNN, the most trusted name in news.
If I called Parkland Hospital as quickly as possible, and got through the switchboard operator, he said, you know, please don't hang up on me. And give me somebody that I can talk to, an authority that might know something. And she's a doctor. And the doctor was very, very matter of fact. And I said, you know, what's happening? What's going on there? And he said, well, he said the president has been brought here, and it's my understanding that he's dead.
People had seen priests go in. And Marianne Means and I were out on the yard of the hospital when we saw the priest come out. And we said, can you tell us anything? And they said, no, we can't tell you anything. And Marianne said, well, is he dead? Is he alive? I forget exactly how she put it. And one of the priests, in my memory of it, was the shorter one, on the other side of the car said, he's dead, all right. It just popped out.
We had what we had. There'd been no official announcement. And I know at the time I was thinking, well, I kind of wish we'd discussed this a little bit more. And they would have said, well, do you think we should play the Star Spangled Banner? Do you think we should announce to the nation and the world that the president is dead? I might have said yes, but I'm not sure. But it wasn't my call. And radio announced it immediately.
A flash from Dallas. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he is dead.
Out of bullet wounds. This is the latest information we have from Dallas. I will repeat with the greatest regret.
We just have a report from our correspondent Dan, rather in Dallas, that he has confirmed that President Kennedy is dead. There is still no official confirmation of this. However, it's a report from our correspondent Dan Rather in Dallas, Texas.
We We came around into a nurse's classroom where all the cameras had been set up and the microphones, and it was full of reporters. And Mack Kilduff, who was the number two White House press spokesman, stood at the desk, and I remember he put his hands on the desk in a funny position like this, pressing so that they bent back like this. And the tears began running down his face. And he said, I regret to announce that at, and somebody said, wait a minute, what time is it? And so they said, well, it's 1:31 or something, whatever it was. Everybody wanted to agree what time. And so he had to start again. And by this time, the tears were just coursing down his cheeks. He was pressing on the desk to get himself under control.
Kilduff said simply, President John Fitzgerald Kennedy died at approximately 1 o'clock. Anyway, I ran across the lobby. There was a man who apparently had just tried to make a phone call and didn't know what I was doing. He was standing looking at the payphone, and I just sort of shoved past him and said, excuse me, I've got to do this, and grabbed the phone and said, Don, he's dead. He's really dead. I could hardly believe it myself. And he said, what, Bill? Calm down. What is it? Who said it? I said, Kilduff, the White House guy. He's dead, Don. He's really dead.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
This CNN Presents is based on President Kennedy Has Been Shot, now in bookstores and at www.museum.org, the interactive museum of news.
Samsung, it's extraordinary. Driven by DNIE technology, Samsung LCD TV, the power of LCD.
Here's a question. If you needed your insurance, who would you call? Not the name of the company, but the name of the person. You've got 2 seconds. Coming up blank, you may want to consider Allstate. You'd have a local agent you can count on, a licensed professional whose name you know, not just a number. You deserve a relationship with a real person. That's Allstate Stand. Are you in good hands?
I never win anything. So the other day when I signed up for Singular Rollover, you know, to be protected from overages, they said, congratulations, you get 500 bonus rollover minutes.
500 bonus rollover minutes!
A great time to sign up for Singular Rollover. Immediately start with 500 bonus rollover minutes. The value of rollover only from Singular.
I call it my woohoo plan.
500 bonus rollover minutes. Another reason Singular fits you best.
All right, bye.
Help guard your inbox with automatic virus protection from MSN. Go to MSN.com. It's better with the butterfly.
One flat rate, right?
Yep.
LA, please. Hey, do you want to be friends?
You seem a little tense.
Do you mind if we stop and see the Grand Canyon? I can smell the ocean.
Flat rate pricing. Bad idea for taxis. Good idea for online trading. At Ameritrade, you pay a flat standard rate of $10.99 for all internet equity trades, with no share limits and no order handling fees. Sign up now and trade commission-free for 5 weeks, plus get our 5-second guarantee. Go to Ameritrade.com/TV/ or call 1-800-Ameritrade.
CNN Monday, 25 years after the Jonestown massacre, a survivor shot 5 times and left for dead breaks her silence. And the soldier Jessica Lynch says he's a real hero. Joins me. I'm Paula Zahn, CNN Monday, 8 p.m.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Suspect on the shooting police officer is apprehended and rushed to the station. Caught him on the lower floor to take a speed and enter fight.
Good
boy. McDonald got up there and he jumped on him. And Oswald hit McDonald real hard with his left hand. And by that time, two or three other cops were there coming from the other side and they jumped on him. And it happened so fast. Within seconds, they had him and they had handcuffed him. And I remember they took him out, and the thing that stuck in my mind all these years, all I heard Oswald say twice was, "I protest this police brutality."
When the door is open in this part of the hospital, and they moved the casket out, and there were these, my friends, you know, tears streaming down their faces. And then Jackie, with her hand on the casket. And that's the first time I saw the bloodstains on her dress. You know, history happens in such kind of squalid places frequently. You know, we have our great ceremonies and that, but the events take place in these small little niches of humanity, and they're often not very attractive. And here we were in the parking lot of the Parkland Hospital, and you know, and just kind of miserable in this white hearse, and it just kind of paralyzed you.
What did he say to you after he was arrested?
He just said, this is it. It's all over with now.
Anything else?
That's all.
When we sped into Love Field, we arrived just as the hearse had finished unloading the casket, the president's casket. And then we boarded the airplane. I counted 28 people in the room. There could have been slightly more than that, but the room was very crowded and very stuffy. The heat was unbearable, really. And President Johnson, when Mrs. Kennedy came in, went to the door and took her by both hands and brought her into the room. And then she stood to his left, Mrs. Johnson stood to his right. And then Judge Hughes, Sarah Hughes, delivered the oath.
Sid Davis jumped off Air Force One and sort of gave a press briefing to all the rest of us about President Johnson, as he was by then, having been sworn in. I know I would run downstairs to the rank of telephone booths and phone in my story.
Hello, I've got some dictation for you on the Kennedy story.
Yeah, where are you, Tom?
I'm in Dallas.
Yeah, okay, boy. Now, take it easy.
Okay, this is Dallas, November 22nd. President John F. Kennedy was shot and killed here today, period. The president suffered a massive gunshot wound in the brain and was pronounced dead at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, period, paragraph.
Up until that time, people depended on print. Print is what validated an event. People didn't really believe it until they had seen it written down in black and white. And that's why that after this happened, people lined up at the Star Telegram and at other newspapers around the country to get these newspapers. They wanted to see it written down in print.
The city editor came over to my desk and gave me a sheet of paper with an address on it, 1026 North Beckley. He said, "We found this is where Oswald lived." go over there. It was a rooming house. Oswald had lived there about 6 weeks. He had taken a room there under an assumed name, O.H. Lee. And I found the house mother, I guess you would call her, Earlene Roberts. She said, he came here after the president was shot. I said, you sure are in a hurry. He didn't answer. He had a, his room was off the dining room. Then I go in, I describe the bed, light blue room, the single bed. The sheets were dumped in a pile. The blanket and the bedspread were dumped up. It had a small air conditioner. There was a pack of chewing gum in the waistband.
This is a scene at Andrews Air Force Base where the casket of carrying the body of President Kennedy is being transferred to an ambulance. The one plane, Air Force One, carried the body, the new president, and the mourning wife. Behind it come Mrs. Kennedy and Robert Kennedy.
I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear. I will do my best. That is all I can do. I ask for your help and God.
The events of that day, in classic journalistic fashion, were not very remarkable. So it was just kind of straightforward reporting. And traveling back on Air Force One, that's what I did. I sat down and wrote, I don't know, I suppose 2,000-3,000 words, just trying to remember every fragment. Things like this, you just wrote from the immediate experience.
I've been to Reno, Chicago, Fargo, Minnesota, Buffalo, Toronto, Winslow, Sarasota, Wichita, Tulsa, Ottawa, Oklahoma, Tampa, Panama, Mattawa, La Paloma, Bangor, Baltimore, Salvador, Amarillo, Tocopilla, Barranquilla, and Padilla. I'm a killer. I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man.
Is full of choices. Stay twice at these Choice Hotels this fall and earn a free night with Choice Privileges. The more you stay, the more you earn. For reservations or more details, visit choicehotels.com. Choice Hotels. We'll see you there.
When you're passionate about something, you never quit. Your multivitamin, Centrum Silver with lycopene, an ingredient in tomatoes that science suggests may help reduce the risk of heart disease. Put your heart into what you love. Centrum Silver with lycopene.
Four flicks.
Yeah, you know, you can only get that DVD here. Get you front and center for the Rolling Stones shows. Hey.
Get Four Flicks, the ultimate live Rolling Stones concert DVD box set, exclusively at Best Buy. Thousands of possibilities. Get yours.
What if it had DVD navigation and laser-assisted cruise control? What if it had a rear-view monitor to see what lies behind it? And one of the most advanced all-wheel drive systems in the world to propel you ahead? What if has become what is? The FX from Infiniti.
CNN Monday on American Morning, sniper suspect John Mohammed's fate is in the hands of the jury, while his alleged partner Lee Malvo faces the initial volley from the prosecution. Don't miss the details straight from the courtroom. Join Bill and Soledad, CNN Monday, 7 Eastern.
CNN's Anderson Cooper.
So I'm supposed to be shooting a promo for my new show.
Hi, I'm Anderson Cooper. Please watch my show.
Absolutely. But I'm not exactly sure what I'm supposed to say.
I got this new show on CNN.
Have guests?
I'm going to have some guests.
The news. Whoosh.
7 o'clock Eastern Time, Monday through Friday.
Monday to Friday, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Monday through Friday, 7 o'clock Eastern Time.
4 o'clock Pacific.
I hope you'll watch.
Anderson Cooper 360, CNN Monday, 7 Eastern.
Are you
moving fast enough to make millions of hearts race. Strong enough to drive away fear. Cool enough to make the competition sweat. They are the drama of the NASCAR Championship on TNT.
Will a prisoner be brought
out? Bring the bag in there. Put the leather bag in there. Put the leather bag in there. Then you had people who had flown in that afternoon from all over the country, and you'd see messages from the New York Times, or their report, and all that. So suddenly we had the national press there.
It was a mob scene, and I don't know who all those people were. I believe I read later that Ruby was there that night because he was a pal of a lot of the cops, and anybody could have been there. But it was very crowded and very hot and seemed very disorganized, and the police seemed quite pleased to be parading their captive back and forth.
Here comes Oswald down the hall again.
Did you buy that rifle? What dispatches you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
Oswald has hustled through a door.
So they take Oswald away. Now I need a telephone. I've got to find a phone to communicate with my office to tell them what the story is. And up comes this character who is wearing a black suit, pinstripe suit, a snap-brimmed gray fedora hat, walked fast, and he came up and he said, "You a reporter?" I said, "Yeah." Now, I thought that he was a detective, because he looked like a vice cop. So I thought, if he's a detective, he has a telephone. So I think I'm going to cultivate this guy. And I said, "No, I'm a correspondent and I'm from New York." And he said, "Well," and then I asked him, "Are you a detective?" And he said, "No, I'm Jack Ruby."
The first thing I was told when I went to work on the police beat was, "Get a hat." And I said, "A hat for what?" They said, "So you'll look more like a detective." So here I was, a 26-year-old kid wearing a snap-brim felt hat. So I would look like a detective.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
You have been.
Nobody
charged.
Said what?
Sir?
You have been.
Nobody
charged.
Said what?
Okay, man.
Okay.
What did you do in Russia?
A policeman hit me.
That was Oswald. Lee Oswald, who was charged with the murder of the President of the United States, so he said he did not know it. He's been taken back upstairs.
Down with the president, yeah.
Up to this point, if you were a print reporter, you had good access to all the detectives, police chief, etc. Now it seemed different. They waited for television lights to come on before they started talking. Suddenly we couldn't get behind the scenes anymore, and it seemed to be that moment in history when television became preeminent in the coverage of an event such as that.
North Portico at that point was draped in mourning crepe, and these 13 lanterns flickering in the driveway with this gray Navy ambulance proceeding up the driveway toward the North Portico. And I tried to capture the feeling here of this moment, and decided to close the broadcast with the poem that President Kennedy would recite on all of his campaign trips.
He liked to quote from Robert Frost many times, but one of the president's favorite quotations, and I believe it went something like this: "I have promises to keep and many miles to go before I sleep." And with that, this is Sid Davis reporting from the White House.
He had just left a couple of days before, healthy and hale, and looking forward to running for election in 1964 and trying to heal the wounds in Texas and doing all of that. And now you've got this 46-year-old president back at the White House in a in a casket.
The line which formed here, estimated by police at 500,000.
It was marvelously solemn and quite elaborate, and guards at attention and around the casket, and you brought your memories to that. I think people were all within themselves and thinking of what Kennedy's death meant to them.
The doors here will remain open until they must be closed at 10 o'clock tomorrow.
CNN Monday, chemical plants, are they safe from terror attacks? I'm Wolf Blitzer. Is enough being done to protect thousands of facilities? And you, 5 p.m. Eastern.
Just a minute. I'm stuck.
If it were up to us, this would be the closest you'd ever come to having complications during pregnancy. The Maternity Center at Mission Hospital delivers nearly 3,000 babies each year and has the experts of Chalk at Mission right down the hall. Just in case.
Message from the law offices of James Sokoloff on mesothelioma. Mesothelioma is a rare, malignant type of cancer in the lungs, usually associated with exposure to asbestos. If you or a loved one have been diagnosed with mesothelioma, call the law offices of James Sokoloff now.
Call 800-981-5896. That's 800-981-5896.
Info, go to OperationGraduation.com.
100 bonus rollover minutes just for switching to Singular. I love that. Get right to the good stuff. Can I have my dessert before my entree? Now, why wait?
Are you Leslie? I'm your blind...
Have a seat.
Now is a great time to sign up for Singular Rollover because you get 500 bonus rollover minutes plus a new Samsung color screen flip phone.
I call it my instant gratification plan.
500 bonus rollover minutes. Another reason Singular fits you best.
CNN, the most trusted name in news.
And if you're rolling, I'll start narration. Here comes the truck.
I have it showing closed now.
From yesterday morning, it has been known that Oswald would be transferred from the Dallas City Jail to the Dallas County Jail.
The idea was we do the service at the National Cathedral, that national prayer service, if you will, do a Harry Reasoner essay, and then segue right in to the transfer of Lee Harvey Oswald. Beautiful plan.
Well, there's no way I can ask the guy any questions. But I'd like to pick up the natural audio from down there. Pick up natural sound from down there.
I was going to be in the basement, and I was not to speak at all. I was going to let Nelson do all the talking. He was going to sit in our van and watch things on the monitors, since we would be switching cameras as the transfer took place.
There he is. There he comes.
Now the prisoner wearing
up. Oswald is coming down from upstairs in the police station. Nelson Benton, who's on the scene, is saying to me in my earpiece, come to us, because he's coming down. I'm saying, New York, come to us, gotta come to us. At first it's said in just about that tone of voice. Very quickly, New York said, well, hold your horses, Harry really likes this essay, spent a lot of time on it, and I want him to get a chance not only to do it, but to do it at his pace. Now I'm saying, well, that's all fine, but keep in mind, this is happening.
There is the president. There is Leon. He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's the man with a gun. It's absolute panic. Absolute panic.
NBC was on the air live.
Detectives have guns.
Of course, it was a few seconds before the CBS people in New York realized that they had to push my button.
We're going to try to bring in Bob Hoffaker of KRLD. Can you hear us down there, Bob? Can you give us an account of what happened?
Oswald fell to the concrete in front of our eyes. Oswald was moved immediately from the area. No one knows.
And then it was a matter of still trying to keep talking and give information and stay on the air while not knowing very much at all.
And an ambulance apparently is moving down now into the basement. Here comes the ambulance. And Oswald will be...
We just blew it, you know, and occasionally you do that. And this is one of the times we did. We didn't think anything was going to happen. Who in the world would have thought that you would take a prisoner in the police station, walk him out to put him in a car or whatever, and somebody's going to shoot him?
Here comes Oswald. He is ashen and unconscious at this time, now being moved in. He's not moving.
The police, in their efforts to mollify or to accommodate all of the world's press, had actually gone ahead with their plan and were going to stage the transfer as scheduled. And as a result, first big live story on television was the shooting of Lee Harvey Oswald by Jack Ruby. And it was covered live around the world.
I think that was the weekend that when television really supplanted the printed press as the national nervous system, you know. I don't think there's any question of it. The press, the television sort of held the country together. People, you know, just clustered around their TVs all day long.
The coverage, especially of the events immediately after the actual assassination, of the lying in state in the rotunda, of the funeral itself, all America was able to join in a national mourning. Indeed, all of the world was.
It is to this day impossible for me to describe the hammer to the heart that the death of President Kennedy and the knowledge, the realization that not only had somebody taken a shot at him, not only somebody hit him with a shot, but they had killed him with a shot, did to the psyche of the country.
Without a doubt, this story was the biggest, most gripping, graphic, emotional story that a reporter could hope to cover or want to cover. I wish I didn't have to cover it.
It was an incredible day, but I soon began to realize that no matter how many bulletins or even flashes I dictated or covered, that nothing would ever quite be the same as that one day in Dallas.
Presents is based on President Kennedy Has Been Shot, now in bookstores and at www.museum.org, the interactive museum of news.